Okay. Good afternoon. Today our topic will be about shoulder MRI. In order to make this presentation easy, I'd like to divide the presentation into four main types. I'll start by MRI safety, just generally, then shoulder anatomy and indications to do the exam, then the positioning of the patient plus the protocol, finally how to complete our exams in the right way. So we should know that MRI is a very strong magnet. It's able to pull the medical devices strongly, so it is not easy thing. We should take this and consider this issue critically and seriously. So we are the people who are responsible to check the patients are safe to do MRIs. There are so many dangerous accidents occur even though for MRI radiographers or the technicians. For example, this occurred because mistakenly they didn't check the patient and the gas cylinder stuck the MRI radiographer with the nerves to the magnets. So they need to do quench in order to take them off. And you should know that the 1.5 Tesla MRI accounts for 50,000 gauss. And the Earth magnetic field is only 0.5 gauss. So you should account that it's very strong and dangerous. So this is our head to make sure that all the patients are safe before going inside the magnet. So all the patients should be screened for being safe to do the MRI. I am just concentrating on the medical devices that may be in the patient and personal belongings which should be taken off. And in case if we need to inject contrast medium, we should make sure that the patient is not allergic, and we do blood analysis to make sure that the renal function test is normal. And finally, pregnancy. This depends on the situation, and this is radiologist's decision. He can decide whether the MRI should be done now or after delivery. So in our hospitals, I could say there are four main contraindicated devices. Yeah, maybe worldwide they invent a new recent which are compatible for MRI, but in our hospital still we don't do these patients. For example, cardiac pacemaker. It is detected by X-ray, easy to detect, but we worry that due to the strong magnetic field, it could lead to switching of the lead of the pacemaker, then may it will be life-threatening emergency to the patient. So we are not allowed to do cardiac pacemakers unless it is certified that this kind of pacemakers is compatible and should be signed by the consultant cardiologist. Two, the aneurysmal clips. These are put via the consultant of neurosurgery. The function of those is just to prevent rupture of the aneurysms. However, if we take this patient to the magnetic field, this could move the clips, leading to injury of the blood vessels and hemorrhage. So again, we do not do this in our department. It is seen easily via X-ray of a skull. Third one I'd like to talk about is the valves of the heart. If these valves are extracted from the animals, it's okay, compatible. Otherwise, if they have ferromagnetic materials component, we are not allowing those patients to undergo an MRI examination. Also, if you have any doubt that the patient might got valves, we do an X-ray, it's easy, safe, then we can decide if we can do the exam or not. Last thing is the hearing aids. If the hearing aids only inserted externally, it's easy to take this off. Otherwise, if these devices are inserted via surgical intervention, it means they are not taken off. So this patient considered as unsafe 100% for MRI. Just these devices I'd like to talk about. Otherwise, MRI safety needs lecture for itself. Before allowing the patient to come in, we should ask the patient to take off all these personal belongings like headphones, credit cards, keys, all things. Just we allow him to go with the gown of our hospital. Otherwise, he is not allowed to be in. Second part of our presentation will be about anatomy and why we should do MRI. Easily, the shoulder is classified as pull and socket joint. It's made up mainly of three bones: clavicle or collarbone, plate or scapula, and the head of the humerus. Medially, the clavicle articulates with the sternum, and laterally with the acromion of the scapula called AC joint or acromioclavicular joint. The area here, or subacromial area, is critical because it has some tendons and porosity which cause loss of shoulder pathology. The anterior surface of scapula is called subscapularis. The posterior side divided into upper and lower part. The lower is called infra. Infra is means pillow. That's why it's called infraspinatus. The one above is called supra, which means above. Supraspinatus. Yeah, this is an X-ray just to show you these names clearly. And yeah, I should let you know that shoulder provides a wide range of movement like abduction, adduction, internal rotation, external rotation. This is the character of pull and socket joints. However, injuring of this kind of shoulders is very high because it is only shallow glenoid cavity. So it depends on the ligaments and tendons to be stable. So any injury to these tendons or ligaments could lead to dislocations or critical injury. So the head of the humerus articulates with the scapula via glenohumeral ligaments. There are three ligaments. One of them is superior, middle, and inferior glenohumeral ligaments. Any injury to those could lead to dislocation, either subluxation or complete dislocation. This is a sagittal view, show you the labrum. Labrum is a rim fibrocartilaginous structures, helps to stabilize the head of the humerus in position. Test to this rim could lead to dislocation as well. A rotator cuff. These are four muscles attached to the scapula. The main function of these muscles is to stabilize the shoulder and helps in the different motions or movement of the shoulder. There are four muscles, and from the name, it is called rotator, means rotation movement of the shoulder. Anteriorly, it is called subscapularis. Posteriorly, as from the name of the surface, the name, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. They attach to the shoulder joint via tendons, and the tendon is called according to the muscle as well. So supraspinatus tendon, infraspinatus tendon, subscapularis tendons. So they are called according to which muscle they are originate from. Okay, the pores, I'd like to just concentrate on the sum of the anatomical structures because they are related to the pathology of the shoulder. The porsa is a fluid-filled sac, and the function of the porsa is just to reduce friction of the bones. There are four porsi in the shoulder, but I concentrate only on the subacromial porsi as it is frequently or most commonly inflamed. Otherwise, the other porsi are small. Now I'd like to talk about the indications of MRI, why we do MRI of the shoulder. There are so many, but I'd like to concentrate on only a few of them, like shoulder severe pain, frozen shoulder or limited movement of the shoulder, impingement. Impingement means stenosis of the subacromial area, where it will cause pressure on the porsi and supraspinatus tendon. So this is called impingement. This leads to infection or inflammation of this area by the time. Rotation cuff syndrome. These are the muscles who control the movement, so any tear of these tendons or tendonitis is related to rotation cuff syndrome. Glenohumeral instability or tear of these ligaments. Subacromial porositis, as I said, porsa is inflamed via impingement, so it is secondary to the impingement. And finally, labral tears. Now, how do we examine? This is our main function as operator. We start after checking the patient is fit to do MRI. We reassure the patient, explain to the patient how the exam is going, the time of the exam, the importance of being stable, not to move during the exam. All these instructions should be fully explained to the patient. Yeah, we should sometimes face patients with claustrophobia. It means that they fear to be inside a confined or closed area. We reassure them, otherwise MRI can't be done. So we put the patient in supine position using shoulder coil, and we should move the coil or the shoulder to be in the center of the magnet, not in the peripheral side. This enhances our image and produce more signal to the image. There are some sequences which are usually done, like coronal, axial, sagittal. They are not fixed depending on the clinical indication and the radiologist opinion. So there is a list of sequences we do usually, but we should confirm with the radiologist about the best sequences he likes to do. We start usually by three-plane localizer. This is very short, few seconds. Give us an axial, coronal, and sagittal view. And in order to plan the axial, we utilize the coronal view, and we should cover superiorly from the AC joint downwards to the axillary recess. To do coronal view, we depend on the axial view, and we align the slices parallel to the supraspinatus muscle. We cover from anterior to posterior, from the coracoid process anteriorly backwards to the infraspinatus muscle. This is technician job. Finally, we utilize the coronal view to plan for sagittal view. We just plan from the lateral border of the humerus inwards to the subscapularis muscle. Do more sequences which help them in writing the diagnosis. So I start by the labral injuries. Labral, as I said, it is the rim that surrounds the glenoid. It helps to stabilize the shoulder. Tears of this is frequent, and MRI is able to show the tears of the labral and to determine which side is it, is superior one, inferior, anterior, or posterior labral. So from the coronal view, we could detect either it is inferior or superior tear. And from the axial, they depend to see which one is being torn. Is it the anterior side of the labrum or the posterior side like this one? That's why MRI is very informative, and they can determine the specific area of torsion. Impingement of the rotator cuff is frequently, and mainly the supraspinatus and subscapulars being torn or being infected. Again, MRI is able to show these from the coronal stair. They could see the turn, hyper signal on the T2 or stair facsat, or sometimes it is like, if it is retracted, I mean moved from this its original place, oedema would be also available. Actually, this is not our task to read, but you should know something. You should help the radiologist, because they might ask you to add new sequences. Also, inflammation of the supraspinatus could be seen. Just look beneath the acromioclavicular joint, and inflammation usually appear as a hyper in T2, stair, and T1. This is an indication of tendinitis or tendinosis. So tendinopathy also could be detected via MRI. Porositis, or infection of the porsa, as I said, this is intact one because there is no pressure on the porsa between the head of the humerus and the acromioclavicular joint. If this area is being stenosed or narrowing, could lead to pressure on the porsa itself and being inflamed. MRI is able to show this type of inflammation, and it's seen on FATSAT, proton density, and T1. It's seen as hyperintense on BD FATSAT and hypointense for BD FATSAT, for T1, sorry. So this is called porositis. And this is the most frequent porsa being inflamed. Also simulitis or infection of the bone. It shows very, it is very aggressive. So lots of changes in the signals could be seen. Oedema is available and it's clear in MRI. Finally, AVN also shows MRI. In MRI, AVN means a vascular necrosis or lock or very low blood supply to the humerus. We are not meant to read, but at least you could see diffuse oedema and fluids in the sclerotic areas, degenerative changes. This could be seen by MRI as well. Finally, sometimes we encounter difficulties in MRI like artifacts. Just I'd like to mention three of them. One of them is called magic angle artifact. This is very critical one because it mimics pathology. Sometimes it's seen as a hyper signals, but it is an artifact. This is due to long TE. This is a technical issue, but as operator we should know and detect. In this situation, just either we make short TE or repositioning the patient and repeating the sequence like this, the signal is being omitted or deleted. So we should recognize the artifacts and the pathology. Two motion artifacts is very common. To overcome this type of artifacts, just we should immobilize the patient and instruct the patient fully, do not move during the exam. Also, if he has a pain, we should ask the referral doctor to give him pain relief before the exams, because this will lead to failure of our exam. Sometimes we use technical issues like short exam, increasing necks. This could help us, but this is not the best solution. Metallic artifacts is there after operation. In this situation, what we can do is only avoiding performing FAT-SAT. Just we do PD without FAT-SAT, T1, T2. It is still informative, but yeah, this is the best solution. Or we use a new sequence called IDEAL.
Or we can,
sorry?
FAT-SAT, we can change it to STAIR.
STAIR.
STAIR
is, yeah.
Useful.
Yeah, you are right. So this at least will minimize the effect of, it is still there, but we try to minimize the effects of metallic implants. Finally, to make sure that our exams is nice, we should make good communication with the patient, good positioning, performance, the full sequences. We should make sure that the radiologist is happy. We are not only dependent on ourselves, we should make sure with him. This is important for me. And finally, if there's any doubt, we might inject contrast medium after the permission of the radiologist. There are some limitations of MRI. It is long, noisy, long waiting list, takes maybe 2 months or more, and it is not widely available. Just we have few centers of MRI. And in private, it is really expensive. Sometimes, if in case of contraindications, we could utilize CT scan. CT scan is as an alternative. It's able to show very tiny fractures, dislocations, very complex bony fractures. We can utilize reconstructions and MIP. This helps the orthopedic before operation, for planning for operation. But we are worried from the high radiation dose and the side effects of contrast medium. However, it couldn't show the ligaments and tendons. Yeah, it's able to show very nice coronal, axial, sagittal. However, the tendons and ligaments, I think, better shown in MRI. Ultrasound is very nice. It's very cheap, available. But to be honest, it needs the skillful of the sonographer. They should power themselves by reading, by using new techniques. It's shown, it's able to show the tendons, especially supraspinal toes, the bone. However, as I said, it needs skillful and more efforts. Yeah, it is not right for the osteopathy, but yeah, it shows ligamentous and tendons injury. This is what I have for today, and I am happy to listen to your questions if you have. It's very short, quick, this because Dr. Faisal told me try to make it not really long. Thank you. I hope it made something.
Yeah, thank you very much for this really very interesting presentation, very nice talk. I enjoyed it really, and it seems there being a big effort into this presentation and preparation. Well done, really. Yeah, well done.
Any question?